Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Media proudly presents Brand Aid, a quick reference guide to solving your branding problems and strengthening your market position. Written by Brad Van Auken. Narrated by Erik Synnestvedt. Foreword. What is a brand, really? In my 30-plus years working in this industry, I've observed the following. Every brand is a promise, and everything is a brand, from products and services to institutions and communities. Building, maintaining, and growing a brand was once all about trust. And trust is something that is earned over time and performance. So the challenge used to be simpler. Demonstrate what your brand believes in, then prove it over time through actions across all touch points. Today, the challenges of building a brand are more complex. We're short-term thinkers, in chase of the next shiny object. Our time is limited. Our attention spans are even shorter. Additionally, the ecosystem in which brands live has evolved. It's a barter system. To get what we need from the consumer, we have to give them something too. We have to give them a meaningful experience. To that end, we barter with entertainment, utility, and shared values. The entertainment and utility bring them into the brand, and the shared values make them stay. So the key to engaging and inspiring consumers today is to make a brand stand for something bigger than its products, to make it share a cultural relativity that connects on a deeper level. As chief executive of Partners in Napier, an ad agency with offices in New York City, San Francisco, and Rochester, New York, I've had the privilege to work with many great brands through a lot of different stages. As a consequence, I've read countless books on the subject of launching, growing, and building brands. This new edition contains all the bits of wisdom and insight Brad has garnered as a veteran of branding, as well as new insights and in-depth information on all the new influences that have exploded in the evolving brand landscape in recent years, from the analytic, such as the importance of big data and social media, to the more fundamental humanistic elements, such as storytelling, social responsibility, and meeting basic human needs. You'll find detailed and extensive coverage of critical aspects that most branding books tend to overlook. From creating consumer brand insistence to non-traditional brand marketing techniques that work, and what it takes to develop a fully functional, empowered, well-running building organization, to the 35 most common brand problems and 21 keys to success. I met Brad for the first time when he was the brand manager of an e-learning brand that we were pitching. Through the course of the pitch process, I sensed that he would be a great client. I also sensed that there was much that I could learn from him. I was impressed not only with the extensive knowledge he had of his brand, but also with the insights he brought to every working session, and his ability to understand the big picture landscape of branding, as well as the subtle nuances that are so critical. And indeed, he proved to be a great client, working with us as a true collaborator, letting us become an extension of his team. As our relationship evolved over the years, he remains a steadfast friend, advisor, and industry colleague whom I truly respect. I've never had a meeting with Brad, even an impromptu one at Starbucks, where I did not glean at least one nugget of invaluable advice. My father used to say, "Be prepared. Be overly prepared." Because in life, a lot of people are going to be smarter than you, but not a lot of people are going to be really prepared. Now I say that to my kids all the time. You are smart, but did you prepare for it? With this new edition of Brand Aid, Brad Van Auken gives us a comprehensive and insightful look at what it really takes to build, nurture, and grow a brand today, as well as what it takes to build and cultivate a brand-driven organization. So, who should read this book? Everyone involved in any facet of the branding process, whether you're just launching your career, or like me, you have 30-plus years in the field. More than a manual of do's and don'ts, it's a catalyst, a map for optimal brand health, and a truly insightful and substantive book on the changing brand landscape. Brad has written it in a way that breaks down the issues and simplifies them, while uncovering new and big insights, providing the preparation needed for any reality today or eventuality that may come your way tomorrow. Everyone who knows me knows that much of what I've learned about leadership, I learned playing basketball, whether it was as a player or from my coaches. For me, within my ad agency, the key is building bench strength. I want everyone on my team, regardless of his or her role, to be prepared. To that end, you can be sure that all the employees at Partners in Napier will have a copy of this invaluable reference tool on their desks. As well, I've made a tradition of giving a book a year to clients and colleagues, and this will be my book for 2014. Sharon Napier, CEO, Partners in Napier, a project worldwide agency. Preface. Today, brands are ubiquitous. In the past decade and a half, I have helped to brand not only companies and their products and services, but also colleges and universities, high schools, municipalities, professional and trade associations, restaurants, sports teams, museums, orchestras, libraries, magazines, health systems, continuing care retirement communities, and a wide variety of other entities. For better or for worse, almost everything in the world is now branded. Why has this marketing discipline become so popular? In an age of increasing product commoditization and choice, the brand is an easy way for people to break through the clutter. It helps them simplify certain choices in their lives. And brands are increasingly fulfilling people's needs for affiliation and identification. Needs that traditional institutions are struggling to meet as well as they used to. Senior management interest in brands has soared for a variety of reasons. Studies have shown that more and more categories are moving toward commoditization as companies A, use increasingly sophisticated customer research to understand and address customer needs, and B, are able quickly to determine and emulate the best practices of their competitors. A strong brand can help combat category commoditization and the resulting downward pressures on price. Manufacturers want to obtain increased leverage vis-a-vis retailers. This is a relationship the manufacturer can own with the consumer. Brands provide a flexible platform for growth, beyond current categories. Deregulation in several industries, notably the utilities, has resulted in a need for differentiation. There is increased competition for consumer dollars. The emergence of the internet has changed commerce. Branding also becomes a critical issue for businesses that are spun off from the parent company, such as AT&T's Bell Labs, now Alcatel-Lucent, and as more and more companies merge or acquire one another. The brand identity of the new combined enterprise becomes critical. Organizations have discovered that brands are perhaps their most important assets, along with their people, for a number of reasons. There is increasing evidence and consensus that strong brands deliver the following benefits to organizations: increased revenues and market share, decreased price sensitivity, increased customer loyalty, additional negotiating leverage with business partners, increased profitability, increased stock price and shareholder value, increased clarity of vision, increased ability to mobilize an organization's people and focus its activities, increased ability to expand into new product and service categories, increased ability to attract and retain high-quality employees. If brand management is new to you or your organization, you most likely need a quick but comprehensive overview of the key elements necessary for successful brand building. I certainly would have found this information very helpful when I assumed the role of Director of Brand Management and Marketing for Hallmark Cards. So with this in mind, I have written this book using what I've learned from a wide variety of sources: books, seminars, consultants, industry benchmarking studies, my own consulting on this subject, and most important, hands-on experience establishing brand management functions and brand-building cultures at Hallmark Cards, and at Element K, now Skillsoft, a leading online learning company. I wrote this book to be a thorough but pithy quick reference guide to all of the most important aspects of brand management and marketing. I have included every concept, template, formula, worksheet, research finding, rule of thumb, checklist, and assessment tool that I have found to be useful in building strong brands throughout my 30-plus years as a marketing practitioner and brand strategy consultant. Feel free to read the book a chapter at a time, or to zero in on the topics that are of greatest interest to you. Most chapters end with a brand management checklist. Use this checklist to identify the areas where your brand practices are strong and where they may be weak. Also use it to identify brand management activities and approaches that are new to you. The checklist takes the form of questions. The more questions to which you can answer yes, the better you are doing. After answering all the questions, it should be obvious which areas of brand practice require your attention. If you have answered no to a question, it should be clear what the associated action step should be. If it is not clear, you should at least be able to identify the general area in which you need help and the type of resources that may be of help to you. Appendix B, which can be found in the accompanying PDF, contains information about online resources to help you further explore topics in much greater detail than can be covered in this book. Also, the boxed Did You Know items scattered throughout the book feature interesting facts, rules of thumb, and other handy information you may find useful as you manage your brand. Finally, I've included brand examples and case studies from a variety of industries and product service categories throughout the book to illustrate key points. New in this revised edition. While the first edition of the book included a chapter on brand building on the internet, it did not include reference to blogs or social media, as those came into popular use between 2001 and 2010. I wrote the original book between 1999 and 2001. It was published in 2003. So, as you might imagine, I have completely rewritten this chapter, which is now titled Online Brand Building. Since I wrote the first edition of the book, shared values, social responsibility, sustainability, brand storytelling, neuromarketing, and big data have surged in popularity with marketers. I have added something about each of these developments in this edition. I added information on private label brands and on upscale consumers and their desires. I also included more depth information on basic human needs, fears, and other behavioral motivators. Based on a burgeoning demand for brand architecture strategy by clients that have grown through mergers and acquisitions, I have expanded my coverage of that topic. I have added information on how to differentiate commodities and how to create category-of-one brands, a particularly powerful but seldom-used branding concept. I now include brand archetypes and a couple of other new elements in brand positioning statements, which are reflected in the new edition of this book. I have also added a section summarizing the 6 most powerful sources of brand differentiation. And finally, I have added many new brand examples featuring more contemporary brands. I have extensively revised the book, but the importance of branding has not changed, nor have its core tenets, so you will find some order material and examples from the first edition of the book. I have not eliminated evergreen material that continues to be relevant today. Did you know? In December 1993, Charles Cobb purchased the Pan Am trademark for $1.32 billion. Disney paid more than 5 times book value for Capital Cities ABC. In 1988, Philip Morris Co. acquired Kraft Foods for $12.9 billion, $11.6 billion over book value. Book Overview. Part 1 is an introduction to brand management, and it assumes no prior knowledge of brand management. Chapter 1 begins with a story that communicates the importance of brand management in a simple but compelling way, and that reinforces the brand's essential role in creating emotional connections and building relationships. The next chapter, in order to establish a common working vocabulary, something brand managers must do within their organizations, defines a number of brand-related terms as a quick reference. Part 1 ends with Chapter 3 and an overview of the brand management process, which serves to put the rest of the book in perspective. Marketing practitioners who have unsuccessfully searched for such an overview will find this visual and verbal presentation, and the context it provides, to be very helpful. The remainder of the book roughly follows this brand management process. Part 2 covers brand design. Brand management must start here, with a thorough understanding of the target consumer as covered in Chapter 4. Do brand marketers understand the consumer's benefit structure, including functional, emotional, experiential, self-expressive, cost of entry, and differentiating benefits, and how it varies by consumer segment? Do they know how to acquire and analyze this information? I include summaries of basic human needs and fears in this chapter. Before marketers can design and position the brand, they must also have a thorough understanding of the competitive set. As Chapter 5 describes, the best benefit for a brand to deliver is one that is very important to the consumer, one for which your organization has unique capabilities, and one that competitors are not adequately addressing. Chapter 6 covers the meat of brand design, defining the brand essence, promise, archetype, personality, and positioning. 7 components of brand design are discussed: target consumer, frame of reference, brand essence, brand promise, brand archetype, brand personality, and brand positioning. The chapter includes templates and exercises to develop each of these brand design components, and also features 3 brand positioning case studies. Chapter 7, which covers the codification of the brand design, addresses the key practical considerations when designing or revamping the brand identity system and standards. It also covers brand naming and the importance of color selection in brand identity development, and highlights tools that can aid in creating brand identity consistency throughout the enterprise. Part 3 focuses on building the brand, and it begins by showing the reader how to create brand insistence. Chapter 8 gets to the heart of brand building. It presents a model that my company, Brand Foreword, has adopted for creating consumer brand insistence in detail. This model is based on extensive research across multiple product and service categories, and it demonstrates that 5 common elements drive consumers to insist upon a particular brand: awareness, accessibility, value, relevant differentiation, and emotional connection. This chapter focuses on different brands to emphasize the importance of each driver. For instance, Coca-Cola, the power of accessibility; McDonald's, the importance of consistent icon repetition; Harley-Davidson, the power of emotional connection building. The chapter concludes with a case study on managing brand equity. Chapter 9 covers the basics of translating a chosen brand strategy and position into effective advertising. This chapter discusses choosing an advertising agency and development of the agency brief, advertising effectiveness evaluations for print, radio, television, outdoor, and overall, and advertising rules of thumb. It also includes an overview of advertising research and a quick advertising assessment tool. Chapter 10 provides brief examples of more than 60 different types of non-traditional brand marketing techniques that work, including those applicable to small businesses and business-to-business organizations. The categories include membership organizations, larger-than-life brand owners, ingredient branding, museum and factory tours, and flagship stores. This chapter also features a list of considerations in getting the news media to cover your story, and it briefly touches upon customer relationship management, CRM, and creative problem-solving and ideation techniques. Chapter 11 covers 11 important areas of online brand building: the brand website, the importance of content, the power of blogs, search engine optimization, online advertising, using social media, web analytics, email marketing, online public relations, mobile apps, and QR codes. Chapter 12 then focuses on what may be the most important and difficult component of brand management within a large enterprise: the non-marketing aspects of brand building, developing the brand-building organization. This is a topic most academicians, consultants, and other non-practitioners nearly always overlook. The chapter answers the all-important questions: how can we make the brand promise real? How can we get our organization to deliver against the promise? How can we align all that we do with the brand's positioning? Chapter 13, on integrated brand marketing, outlines all the components that must be integrated to consistently deliver against the brand promise. It covers traditional marketing elements such as product, packaging, pricing, distribution, advertising, promotion, and publicity. It also covers human resource and organization design components that must be aligned in support of the brand's promise, and presents an overview of the most important integrative mechanisms. Brands are more than names and logos that are applied to products and services. They're the source of integrated consumer experiences. Chapter 14 addresses how to create those experiences and gives several examples of situations in which the total brand experience has been created. A simple list of questions is provided to help you optimize your total brand experience. Finally, the chapter presents an overview of effective crisis management, or what to do when the brand experience goes awry. Part 4 covers the R in brand ROI, leveraging the brand for increased revenues and profits. I focus on two ways of generating return: through brand extension and by leveraging the brand globally. Chapter 15 discusses ways to leverage your brand's equity and prolong its life by extending the brand into new product and service categories, and touches upon the most likely brand extension pitfalls and how to avoid them. Chapter 16 begins by highlighting the advantages of global branding, and then discusses the most important considerations in building global brands. Part 5 addresses brand metrics. Most organizations conduct ongoing market, consumer, and competitor research to help them position and reposition their brands. Others monitor and measure their brand's equities. Some organizations also measure the effectiveness of specific marketing programs. Chapter 17 covers the spectrum of brand research, from logo recognition and recall to brand extension, emphasizing in-depth qualitative techniques that lead to a better understanding of consumer needs. How can you manage what you haven't measured? Chapter 18 provides a detailed look at brand equity measurement. It is based on Brand Forward's brand insistence model, which incorporates the latest thinking on brand equity measurement. The model includes the 5 brand equity drivers covered in Chapter 8, as well as measures of usage, preference, consideration set ranking, loyalty, and vitality. Part 6 covers 2 miscellaneous brand management topics: the relationship of brand management issues to organization age and size, and legal issues in brand management. Chapter 19 looks at how older or larger companies differ from younger, smaller companies on a number of dimensions, and how those differences affect the brand management issues they are likely to encounter. These key dimensions include leadership, size, business scope, brand structure, organization infrastructure, corporate culture, marketplace, decision-making, financial resources, primary marketing method, brand identity, brand awareness and esteem, and brand differentiation. Chapter 20 focuses on the most important concepts marketing managers should understand about trademark law and protection. It also covers trade dress, trade secrets, false or deceptive advertising, and intellectual property issues on the internet. Finally, Part 7 serves as a brand management summary. Chapter 21 outlines 35 of the most common brand problems that organizations encounter in managing, building, and leveraging their brands. It briefly analyzes each problem and offers practical suggestions on how to address the problem. These real-life problems are based on the experience of marketing practitioners in a variety of organizations. The book's final chapter features 21 keys to success in brand building. The chapter includes a quick brand health assessment and my prognostications about the future of branding. The first of the book's appendixes explains the value of a brand audit. Through a brand audit, an organization can assess the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats of its brand and its brand management practices. Appendix A, which can be found in the accompanying PDF, outlines the components of a brand audit, offers suggestions on what to look for when selecting an outside brand auditor, and features a quick, 6-question brand health assessment. Appendix B, which can be found in the accompanying PDF, contains a list of online brand management and advertising resources, including URLs for a wide variety of articles and publications on brand management and advertising. Part 1. Introduction to Brand Management. 1. A brand is a friend. Business leaders talk about the importance of maintaining strong brand equity. But is there consensus on what brand equity is? Some people say it's everything associated with the brand that adds to or subtracts from the value it provides to a product or service. Others emphasize the financial value of the brand asset. Still others stress the consumer loyalty or price premium generated by brand equity. Some even talk about the permission and flexibility a brand gives an organization to extend into new product and service categories. While all of these opinions are very important parts of brand equity, I think the following story best illustrates what brand equity is. Imagine you are having lunch with a longtime and very good friend. Several times throughout the lunch, she makes disparaging and sarcastic remarks that make you feel bad. You think to yourself, "This just isn't like her. She must be having a bad day." You meet with her again a week or two later, and again she acts ornery and negative. You think to yourself, "Something must be going on in her life that she's really struggling with. Maybe she is having difficulties with her job, or her health, or her marriage, or her children." You may even ask her if everything is all right. She snaps back, "Of course it is." Your interaction with her continues in this vein over the next couple of months. You continue to try to be supportive, but she's definitely getting on your nerves. After many meetings and much interaction, you finally decide that she's a changed person and someone with whom you prefer to spend less and less time. You may get to this point after a few months, or perhaps even after a year or more. She doesn't change, and eventually the relationship peters out. Now consider for a moment that the person you first had lunch with is the same person as before, with one exception. She is a total stranger to you. You haven't met her previously, and she is not your dear friend. I would guess that after enduring many caustic comments and being insulted a few times at that lunch, your first impression wouldn't be very positive. In fact, you'd probably be inclined not to get together with that person again. You'd probably walk away from that lunch thinking, "What a miserable person. I hope I don't run into her again." In both of these scenarios, it is the same person behaving the same way in the same situation. Yet in the first scenario, you are very quick to forgive the behavior. In fact, you feel a lot of concern toward her. In the second scenario, you can't wait for the lunch to be over, and you hope never to see the person again. In the first scenario, the person was a longtime good friend. She had a lot of equity with you. In the second scenario, she had no equity at all. You see, if people or brands have a lot of equity, that is, if you know, like, and trust them, you will cut them a lot of slack, even if they repeatedly fail to meet your expectations. If a person, product, service, or organization has no equity with you, no emotional connection, and no trust, then you are much less inclined to forgive unmet expectations. Did you know? Familiarity more often breeds liking. Declining brands tend to lose buyers, while the brand's loyalty and purchase rates stay stable among remaining buyers. In most product categories, price is the primary purchase incentive for no more than 15% to 35% of all customers. Brand equity creates a relationship and a strong bond that grows over time. It is often so strong that it compensates for performance flaws, whether an out-of-stock situation, poor customer service, a product that falls apart, inconvenient store hours, or a higher-than-average price. In the end, you want to deliver good quality and good value, innovation, relevant differentiation, convenience, and accessibility with your brand. However, we must never forget that building brand equity is like building a close friendship. It requires a consistent relationship over time, trust, and an emotional connection. 10 signs that people do not understand marketing. 1. They never think about the customer and that individual's motivations and needs. 2. They define marketing as sales support. 3. They use the terms sales and marketing interchangeably. 4. They use the terms marketing and advertising interchangeably. 5. They think about marketing as a cost center or overhead, rather than as an investment. 6. They only think of marketing as its tools and tactics, not as an integrated process that delivers on a strategy. 7. There is no well-thought-out media plan. 8. They believe marketing should copy whatever the competitors are doing. 9. They think anyone can do marketing, ignoring that it is a discipline based on training and experience. 10. They can't see the link between marketing strategy and business strategy. 2. Understanding the language of branding. It is important to establish a common brand management vocabulary in your organization. Establishing this common vocabulary will ensure that people can communicate with fewer misunderstandings. More important, it will help communicate and reinforce key brand management principles. I worked with organizations in which different managers used different terms to describe positioning the brand. Terms ranged from essence and promise to position and unique value proposition. This caused great confusion. I worked with other organizations that struggled with the differences among master brand, family brand, parent brand, umbrella brand, corporate brand, brand, sub-brand, endorsed brand, product brand, etc. The aim is to agree on one set of terms and to simplify the brand architecture. Brand. The American Marketing Association describes a brand as a name, term, sign, symbol, or design, or a combination of them, intended to identify the goods and services of one seller or group of sellers and to differentiate them from those of competition. More important, a brand is the source of a promise to the consumer. It promises relevant, differentiated benefits. Everything an organization does should be focused on enhancing delivery against its brand's promise. Combining a few different definitions, a brand is the name and symbols that identify the source of a relationship with the consumer, the source of a promise to the consumer, the unique source of products and services, the single concept that you own inside the mind of the prospect. According to brand management experts Al Reese and Laura Reese, in their book, The 22 Immutable Laws of Branding, the sum total of each customer's experience with your organization. Finally, another way to think about brands is that they are personifications of organizations and their products and services. In this way, brands can hold certain values, have specific personalities, possess admirable qualities, stand for something, make promises, and create emotional connections with people. The origin of brands. Brands date back to earliest recorded history, when they were used to indicate the origin of a product and information about its quality. As far back as 2250 BCE, researchers have found evidence of brands being used by craftspeople and merchants in trade. They often took the form of seals featuring pictorial symbols and text. Brands, stamping with embers or hot irons, were also used to identify harlots or wrongdoers and to identify livestock ownership. Brand equity. Brand equity is the commercial value of all associations and expectations, positive and negative, that people have of an organization and its products and services due to all experiences of, communications with, and perceptions of the brand over time. This value can be measured in several ways, as the economic value of the brand asset itself, as the price premium to the end consumer or the trade that the brand commands, as the long-term consumer loyalty the brand evokes, or as the market share gains it results in, among many others. From an economist's perspective, Brand equity is the power of the brand to shift the consumer demand curve of a product or service, to achieve a price premium or a market share gain. To use a metaphor, brand equity is like a pond. People may not know how long the pond has been around or when it first filled with water, but they know that it supports life, from ducks to deer. It also may provide recreation, irrigation, even human drinking water. Clearly, it is a valuable resource. But many people take the pond for granted. It seems as if nothing can diminish its supply of water, yet we sometimes notice that it rises with the spring rains, or lowers after a long drought or overuse for irrigation. Similarly, brand equity is a reservoir of goodwill. Brand-building activities consistently pursued over time will ensure that the reservoir remains full. Neglecting those activities or taking actions that might deplete those reserves will reduce the reservoir, imperceptibly at first, but soon all too noticeably until it is too late and all that is left is mud. This illustrates a chronic difficulty in brand management. Brand equity is critically important to a company's success, yet because of its reservoir-like nature, it is often taken for granted, overly drawn upon, and not adequately replenished, especially in times of crisis or to meet short-term needs. Brand image. Brand image is the totality of perceptions resulting from all experience with and knowledge of the brand. It is how consumers perceive the brand. Brand associations. Brand associations are anything consumers associate with the brand in their minds. As David Aker, guru of brand management, points out, these associations could be organizational, product-related, symbolic, or personified. If there is a strong brand connection with a specific retail outlet, the associations could also be based on the retail experience. Other brand equity components not listed here, but covered in detail in Chapters 8 and 18, include awareness, accessibility, value, relevant differentiation, emotional connection, preference, usage, loyalty, and vitality. Brand positioning. Brand positioning is the way the brand is perceived within a given competitive set in the consumer's mind. Ideally, it is a function of the brand's promise and how the brand compares with other choices with regard to quality, with innovation, perceived leadership, value, prestige, trust, safety, reliability, performance, convenience, concern for customers, social responsibility, and technological superiority. Relevant differentiation is the most important aspect of brand positioning. One could argue that brand essence, promise, archetype, and personality are all a part of the brand positioning. Given that, brand positioning is very similar to what I referred to as brand design in Chapter 3. Brand positioning elements can be intentional and crafted by the marketer, for instance, as written in the brand positioning statement. The brand essence, promise, archetype, and personality can also exist in the mind of the consumer. Ideally, what is in consumers' minds is congruent with the intended brand positioning. If not, hopefully the brand management team is actively managing the brand so that congruence will occur. Brand essence. This is the heart and soul of a brand's fundamental nature or quality. Usually stated in 2 to 3 words, a brand's essence is the one constant across product categories and throughout the world. Some examples are Nike, authentic athletic performance. Hallmark, caring, shared. Disney, fun family entertainment. Disney World, magical fun. Starbucks, rewarding everyday moments. The Nature Conservancy, saving great places. Typically, it is rare for an organization's brand essence and slogan to be the same. For instance, Nike's essence, authentic athletic performance, was translated to the following 2 slogans, Just Do It and I Can. The Nature Conservancy's brand essence, however, also served as its previous slogans, Saving the Last Great Places and Saving the Last Great Places on Earth. Its current slogan is Protecting Nature, Preserving Life. Kevin Keller, brand expert and author of the popular book Strategic Brand Management, has coined the term brand mantra, which is very closely related to brand essence. The mantra concept reinforces the role of brand essence in internal communication. According to Keller, brand mantra should define the category of business for the brand and set brand boundaries. It should also clarify what is unique about the brand. It should be memorable. As a result, it should be short, crisp, and vivid in meaning. Ideally, the brand mantra would also stake out ground that is personally meaningful and relevant to as many employees as possible. Brand DNA. This term has been used in a variety of ways. However, it is similar to the brand's essence. It is the core stuff of which the brand is made, including its core values, competencies, and passions. Brand promise. To be successfully positioned in the marketplace, a brand must promise differentiated benefits that are relevant and compelling to the consumer. The benefits can be functional, experiential, emotional, or self-expressive. A brand promise is often stated as, "Only brand name delivers benefit in product or service category." Sometimes with corporate brands, it is stated as, "Brand name is the trusted, quality, innovative leader in benefit in the product or service category." To be believable, brand promises require compelling proof points and what advertising professionals call reasons to believe in support of the brand's promise. A brand promise must address important consumer needs, leverage your organization's strengths, give you a competitive advantage through differentiation, inspire, energize, and mobilize your people, drive every organizational decision, system, action, and process, manifest itself in your organization's products and services. As respected marketing consultant Kristen Zhivago once said, "The simple truth about branding, a brand is not an icon, a slogan, or a mission statement. It is a promise your company can keep. First, you find out, using research, what promises your customers want companies like yours to make and keep, using the products, processes, and people in your company. Then you look at your competition and decide which promise would give you the best competitive advantage. This is the promise you make and keep in every marketing activity, every action, every corporate decision, every customer interaction. You promote it internally and externally. The promise drives budgets and stops arguments. If everyone in the company knows what the promise is and knows that they will be rewarded or punished depending on the personal commitment to the promise, politics and personal turf issues start to disappear." The brand promise should drive organizationally, mission and strategy, communication, operations, systems and logistics, products and services, and values and behaviors. Unique value proposition. A brand's unique value proposition is what makes it unique and compelling to its target customers. In this way, a brand's unique value proposition is similar to its promise. One could say that unique value propositions are very important to brands, and that brands should promise and deliver on those unique value propositions. Brand personality. Brand personality refers to adjectives that describe the brand, such as fun, kind, sexy, safe, sincere, sophisticated, cheerful, old-fashioned, reliable, progressive, etc. How consumers perceive a brand's personality is often discovered through qualitative research by asking people to describe the brand as if it were a person or an animal. Brand archetype. If the brand personality is composed of a set of adjectives that describe the brand as if it were a person, the brand archetype goes a level deeper to identify the primary quality or motivation that underlies the brand's view of the world and its behavior. In The Hero and the Outlaw, Building Extraordinary Brands Through the Power of Archetypes, Margaret Mark and Carol S. Pearson focus on 12 archetypes that drive the brand. In his book, Winning the Story Wars, Jonah Sachs provides examples of 7 archetypes: the pioneer, the rebel, the magician, the jester, the captain, the defender, and the muse. We use 27 different archetypes when we work with clients. Example archetypes include achiever, advocate, explorer, guide, healer, poet, sage, trickster, and wizard, among others. Tip: for nonprofit organizations loath to use the word brand because of its corporate or business overtone connotation, but who still want to actively manage their brands internally and externally, consider using promise instead. For instance, talk about managing our promise, or delivering our promise, or state that name's promise is. Brand identity. Brand identity is a combination of visual, auditory, and other sensory components that create recognition, represent the brand promise, provide differentiation, create communication synergy, and are proprietary. Some people define brand identity more broadly to include almost everything in a brand's design, including essence, promise, personality, and positioning. The more specific definition used in this book reflects the most common usage of the term, especially as used by firms focused on the creation of brand identity systems and standards. Names and nomenclature, logo types, symbols and other graphic devices, distinctive shapes and colors, brand voice and visual style, sounds, jingles and other mnemonic devices, typography, theme lines or slogans, and characters that are uniquely associated with a brand are all components of a brand's identity. Textures, scents, flavors, and other sensory elements also can be components of a brand's identity. Brand portfolio. Brand portfolio is the mix of brands and sub-brands owned by an organization. This portfolio should be actively managed to ensure effective, efficient brand management. For example, P&G, Unilever, and Kraft Foods Group all have very large portfolios of brands. General Motors manages Buick, Cadillac, and other brands. Hallmark manages the Hallmark, Shoebox, and Crayola brands, among others. Darden Restaurant Group manages the Red Lobster, Olive Garden, Longhorn Steakhouse, Bahama Breeze, Seasons 52, The Capital Grille, Eddie V's, and Yard House brands. Marriott brands include Marriott Hotels and Resorts, Courtyard, Fairfield Inn & Suites, Residence Inn, JW Marriott, The Ritz-Carlton, and others. Brand architecture, or brand structure. Think of brand architecture as a brand's family tree, or its hierarchy. It is how an organization organizes the various named entities within its portfolio and how they relate to each other. Ideally, the brand architecture is simple, with no more than two levels, brand and sub-brands. In fact, brand-sub-brand is the type of architecture most often used. It takes many forms, mostly based upon the type of name used for the sub-brands. Some organizations add a third level, named products. But any more than two levels can be confusing. The four general types of architecture are 1. Master brand, 2. Brand sub-brand, 3. Endorsed brand, 4. Separate, standalone, or independent brands. Brand architecture addresses the following: number of separately named entities, criteria for becoming a separately named entity, levels of relationships between separately named entities, naming and other brand identity conventions for each level. Corporate brand. Corporate brand is the brand bearing the company name. It is always the highest in a brand hierarchy. Examples are Ford, Hewlett-Packard, IBM, General Motors, 3M, and Kodak. Master brand. Master brand is the dominant, highest-level brand in a brand hierarchy. Corporate brands are typically master brands, unless they are largely invisible by design, such as P&G or Unilever. As the Ford example points out, the same brand can be a corporate, master, and parent brand. Parent brand. Parent brand is a brand that is extended into more than one product category. It may or may not be the same as the corporate brand. Examples are Ford and Honda. Parent brands offer the following advantages: less expensive new product launches, trust, assurance, marketing economies of scale. Sub-brand. A sub-brand is a new brand that is combined with a parent or corporate brand in the brand identity system. The sub-brand can make the parent brand more vital and relevant to a new consumer segment or within a new product category. Examples are Ford Taurus and Honda Accord. Endorsed brand. Endorsed brand is the primary name the consumer uses to refer to a product. It is a brand that is endorsed by the parent or corporate brand in the brand identity system. The parent brand is also identified with the product. However, the endorsed brand is given much greater visual weight than the parent brand. In this situation, the corporate or parent brand lends credibility or assurance to the endorsed brand without overpowering it with its own associations. An example is Shoebox, a tiny division of Hallmark. Private label. Private label describes products or services that are manufactured or otherwise sourced by one company to be sold under another company's brand name. Private label manufacturers can be large national brand manufacturers that use their excess manufacturing capacity to supply store brands, or smaller manufacturers that focus on creating store brands for others, or major retailers or wholesalers who manufacture their own brands, or regional manufacturers that concentrate on providing private label brands for specific markets.
Many retailers across a variety of categories have created their own store brands. According to the Food Marketing Institute, nearly all grocers offer their own store brands. And store gross margins are significantly higher, 35% for store brands, than for nationally advertised brands, 25.9%. Often, retailers use private label brands to offer lower-priced alternatives to nationally advertised brands. However, retailers are increasingly creating their own premium store brands.
Offering store brands decreases the leverage that nationally advertised brands have vis-a-vis retailers, which makes it even more important for national advertisers to strengthen the equity of their brands to maintain leverage in the marketplace. Historically, people perceived private label brands to be knockoffs of nationally advertised brands. But increasingly, people perceive them to be acceptable alternatives to nationally advertised brands. And loyalty to a store brand translates to loyalty to a store. Trade dress. Trade dress refers to aesthetic elements that provide legal protection for a brand's identity. For example, Coca-Cola's bottle shape is part of its trade dress, as are Absolute Vodka's bottle shape and Harley-Davidson's engine sound. Brand extension. Brand extension means applying the existing brand to new products, services, or consumer segments. If done by combining an existing one with a new brand, the new is called a sub-brand. Executed properly, brand extensions can broaden and clarify the meaning of the brand. Improperly done, they can dilute or confuse the brand's meaning. Examples are Crayola, from crayons to markers and pens, and Jell-O, from gelatin to pudding. Marketing plan. A marketing plan is a request for funds in return for a promised level of incremental revenues, unit sales, market share, or profits. One can develop marketing plans for products, services, market segments, or brands. The critical components of a marketing plan include the following. Summary. Objectives, e.g. attract new consumers, create new uses, increase share of requirements, incent trial, encourage repeat purchase, encourage add-on purchase, increase awareness, increase loyalty, change value perception, increase emotional bond, or extend into new product and service categories. Situation analysis. Market analysis. Competitive context.
Customer profile.
E.g. segments, needs, attitudes, behaviors, insights. Strategies and tactics. Touching upon all key marketing components that will be used. Product, packaging, pricing, distribution, advertising, publicity, sales promotion, and selling. Be specific. Operations considerations, e.g., impact on plant capacity or need for new assets. Financial projections, pro forma profit and loss statements, balance sheets, cash flows, etc. funds required to execute plan. Supporting customer research, including qualitative research, concept testing, volumetric modeling, and market test results. Risks and contingency plans. Brand plan. A brand plan is similar to a marketing plan. Its objectives focus primarily on changing or improving brand equity components. Increased market share is a frequently specified brand objective. Others include brand awareness, brand accessibility, brand value, brand relevant differentiation, brand emotional connection, brand vitality, brand loyalty, brand personality, other brand associations. 3. Brand management process, an overview. The brand management process starts with a deep understanding of consumers and competitors. You need to fully understand the consumer benefit structure by segment, including which benefits are cost of entry and which are differentiating.
In-depth qualitative consumer research will help uncover this information. You will also need to know which benefits each of your competitors delivers in consumers' minds. Ultimately, you will need to know which benefits are important, personally relevant, unique and differentiating, purchase motivating, and appropriate for your brand.
You also need to know that consumer benefits can be functional, emotional, experiential, or self-expressive. Once you acquire all this knowledge, you can begin to design your brand. Designing your brand. In brand positioning or design, there are 5 components to be addressed. 1. Target audience. Define the target customer. 2. Brand essence. Articulate the heart and soul of the brand. 3. Brand promise. Develop the relevant, differentiating benefits the brand promises to deliver to its target audience. 4. Brand archetype. Identify the driving motivation behind the brand. 5. Brand personality.
Describe the brand as if it were a person.
As you address these 5 components, especially brand promise, you need to define your brand's competitive frame of reference and map out how it is positioned against competitors. Although this may sound like a linear process, it is actually iterative and even organic. In the end, though, you will have determined each of the elements of your brand's design. Figure 3-2 provides an overview of the brand management process and can be found in the accompanying PDF. Once the brand is designed, this design must drive all your consumer communication, all your other marketing elements, and your organization's design, particularly the company culture. It must also drive what Michael Porter, Harvard Business School professor and thought leader, calls the customer value chain. According to the value chain concept, each activity an organization undertakes should lead to added value to its target consumers. If it doesn't, it should be reevaluated and possibly eliminated. The brand design should be directly translated into and supported by the brand identity standards and systems.
This process ensures that the brand design is realized at each point of contact with the consumer, resulting in a total brand experience. If done right, a brand and the experience it delivers transcend the brand's products and services. In essence, you are selling the brand experience more than anything else.
All of this should deliver awareness, relevant differentiation, value, accessibility, and emotional connection, the key components in creating brand insistence.
Ultimately, strong brand equity should result in price premiums, decreased price sensitivity, increased consumer loyalty, increased flexibility for future growth, increased market share, and increased shareholder value.
The most important tasks of a brand management function: develop and execute brand plans, including brand marketing plans. Build brand awareness. Position the brand for sustainable competitive advantage. Transform the organization's leadership team into brand champions. Transform all employees into brand champions. Measure and actively manage your brand's equity. Actively manage the brand's identity, including enforcement of its guidelines and standards. Legally protect the brand. always keep the brand customer-focused.
Design and implement plans to create emotional connection between your brand and its customers. Develop and execute brand loyalty programs.
Research that supports the brand management process. There are many types of research that aid in the brand management process. Some are ongoing, while others are only conducted periodically or as needed. Ongoing research includes brand equity, marketing effectiveness, and competitive monitoring, among other categories of research. Monitoring brand equity.
Brand equity monitoring should highlight changes in consumers' attitudes, preferences, and behavior regarding your brand. It should also play a diagnostic role, giving insight into the whys those changes occur. While some brands, such as Coca-Cola, monitor brand equity on an ongoing basis, many brands conduct a more comprehensive brand equity snapshot every year or two. Monitoring marketing effectiveness. Marketing effectiveness monitoring takes many forms, from simple testing of advertising copy to using an ongoing system to identify the relative effectiveness of each element in your marketing mix, including estimates of return on marketing investment. It can even be more detailed, including analysis of effectiveness against different marketing objectives, such as customer retention, share of requirements, category buying rate, in-store capture, and conversion rates. Competitive monitoring. Competitive monitoring can take many forms, from daily panel studies and market tours, to product preference testing and POS, point-of-sale data analysis, chain-specific data, or from AC Nielsen, ScanTrack, or IRI, Data Server, FastTrack, and InfoScan. One-time or periodic research includes attitude and usage studies, in-depth qualitative consumer research, focus groups, conjoint analysis, perception analyzer testing, recognition and recall tests, concept testing, benefit testing, and test markets. Brand extension research. A brand is an asset, and to provide strong shareholder value, assets must be leveraged. Brand extension is the primary way of doing that. Brand extension can be a powerful way to optimize the performance of your brand, but it also can be a complicated endeavor. Brand extension and brand extension research are discussed in detail in chapters 15 and 17. Brand manager competencies and responsibilities. Brand manager competencies. Strong ability to influence behaviors and perceptions without formal authority. Respected throughout the organization. Strong written and verbal persuasion skills. Adequate analytical skills. Customer research experience. Strong intuition about human behavior and motivation. Good project management skills. Brand manager responsibilities. Identify, refine the brand's unique value proposition. Monitor, measure, and manage brand equity strength. Increase brand awareness, relevant differentiation, value, accessibility, and emotional connection. Develop brand plan. Monitor progress against brand plan. Be responsible for results against brand plan. Drive brand understanding and support organization-wide. Champion drive initiatives that support delivery of the brand promise. Develop brand messaging, elevator speech, tagline, campaign themes, proof points, etc. Brand identity manager competencies. Strong ability to influence behaviors and perceptions without formal authority. Respected throughout the organization. Likeable. Assertive. Ability to say no in a nice way. Some understanding of brand identity standards and systems. Brand identity manager responsibilities. Manage the brand architecture. Establish brand architecture and naming decision rules. Establish brand identity standards, including co-branding standards. Maintain brand identity consistency. Chair the brand identity council, team, board. Help manage brand identity transitions resulting from mergers and acquisitions. Help determine identities for new brands, sub-brands. Anticipate and accommodate new brand identity needs.
Part 2. Designing the Brand. 4. Understanding the Consumer. Organizations exist for one purpose: to meet human needs. Thriving organizations do that exceedingly well. Venerated organizations have managed to meet evolving human needs over a long period of time. All of an organization's revenues and profits result from one thing: customers who are willing to pay money for products and services that meet their needs. Therefore, any brand management initiative, any marketing initiative, and indeed any business or organizational initiative, must start with a solid understanding of the customer. Defining the target customer. Focus is an important part of a brand's success. Brands focus on a target customer and often narrow their focus to a particular customer need segment. As mentioned in Chapter 3, customer targeting is the first step in brand design. Everything else emanates from that. So let us start with how to identify your brand's target customers. Look for customers who meet the following criteria. They have an important need, and your brand meets that need. Your brand has the potential to be preferred by them. There is something about your brand that they admire. They have the potential to provide your organization with ample revenues and profits over the long run. Your organization can grow by building a long-term relationship with and increasingly fulfilling the evolving needs of these customers. At a minimum, you should identify and understand the following target customer attributes: demographics, lifestyle, needs, desires, hopes, aspirations, fears, concerns, product purchase behavior, product usage behavior. Basic human needs. As branders, it is useful to understand the basic needs that drive human emotions and behaviors. Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs addresses this requirement, as does Artur Manfred Max Neef's classification of fundamental human needs. Albert T. Poffenberger, Ph.D., devotes an entire chapter to An Inventory of Human Desires in his book Psychology and Advertising, published in 1925. I have been a student of basic human needs for the better part of 30 years. Here is my list of basic human needs, going from survival needs to such higher-order needs as self-actualization and enlightenment, compiled and revised over time from numerous sources. 1. Appetite, hunger. 2. Safety, security. 3. Physical comfort. 4. Health, well-being. 5. Sexual gratification. 6. Competence, mastery. 7. The desire to matter. 8. Ability to contribute, make a difference. 9. The desire to be heard, understood. 10. Respect. 11. Recognition. 12. Self-esteem, sense of self-worth. 13. Affection. 14. Friendship. 15. Sense of belonging. 16. Control. 17. Autonomy. 18. Freedom. 19. Creative expression, playfulness. 20. Growth. 21. Meaning. 22. Beauty. 23. Wholeness, oneness. As marketers and crafters of brand strategy and messaging, we should be cognizant of the underlying needs that drive human behaviors, including brand purchase and usage behaviors. The next time you craft strategy for your brand, think about which of these fundamental human needs your brand fulfills, and then make sure you are reinforcing that need fulfillment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.